this. And this, okay. Today, this is lecture 49, Legionella, Bordetella, and Haemophilus. I'm sorry if my voice starts to sound funny, but I have serious allergy issues this time of year. So between the antihistamines and the decongestants, I don't have much of a voice left. So we're going to discuss Legionella, Bordetella, and Haemophilus, which are gram-negative rods involved with the respiratory tract. So the way I have this particular lecture organized is we'll have an overview at the beginning of each organism, then we'll talk about the organisms of clinical importance with each one, the microbiology, public health issues, pathogenic mechanisms, clinical presentation. All right, the first organism we're going to talk about is Legionella. Legionella is a facultative intracellular pathogen. It is a gram-negative rod. It requires specialized media to grow, which is why it was not recognized as an organism until the 1970s. It stains very poorly with a gram stain. It's transmitted via contaminated aerosols. And as far as we know, there has never been any person-to-person transmission. There are two species, really, of clinical importance here. First, let's talk about the Legionella in general. There's only one genus, but there's at least 50 species, and it seems like every year they come up with another species. But only about half of the species have been implicated in human disease. Now, we're talking about somebody comes up with, oh, I found one new one that's been implicated in one case of disease. But really, 90% of the cases of Legionellosis are caused by Legionella pneumophila. And of the Legionella pneumophila, most of the cases are caused by serogroups 1 and 6. After Legionella pneumophila, we get Legionella McDadii, and they are the most common cause of disease after Legionella pneumophila. Now, one thing you need to be aware of with Legionella McDadii is that when it's originally isolated, it can weakly stain as an acid-fast bacteria. Now, this does not mean that it has any relationship to mycobacteria, because it doesn't. But it can weakly stain acid-fast, but it will lose this characteristic after it's been grown in vitro. So don't let anybody fool you on a test with this. Now, the microbiology. One of the main reasons that this organism was never recognized, it will not grow on standard culture media, specifically sheep blood agar. Won't grow, no way, no how, not going to happen. It required a lot of effort for them to come up with a specialized media. It's called buffered charcoal yeast extract agar. I did my PhD on this organism. It's a pain in the neck to make this media. It has about 10 different ingredients. You have to pH it very, very carefully. You have to filter sterilize some of the ingredients. It is a real pain in the neck. It's buffered because this organism has a very narrow pH range that it will grow in that you don't really need to care about. But what you do need to know is it does require cysteine and it does require iron to grow. It has charcoal in it because it can't handle any of the nasty little ingredients that you can even have in your water. It really is very fastidious. It likes 35 degrees, and it grows very slowly from 3 to 7 days before you'll see anything. One of the nice things about this, certain species, and this is just a little note on the side, is they fluoresce. You put them under a black light, and they glow. They're really neat. They have an interesting characteristic. They call it a ground glass appearance. You notice how these are like nice and smooth looking, and these look like somebody's ground glass up and put them. They're very small colonies, and they're nice and round, and they have this ground glass appearance. They stain very poorly. If you do a gram stain, they're the gram negative rods, and Sometimes they won't even pick up the stain much at all. You look under a microscope and you can barely see them, but they are gram negative rods. Laboratory diagnosis. This is from the CDC. This is what the Centers for Disease Control recommend that the clinical labs do for diagnosis of the case of Legionella culture. If you can get Legionella to grow from a sterile tissue, like lungs in particular, this may sound fairly simple. Okay, you get some sterile, you suction a patient's lungs out and you grow it. No, not so easy. A lot of labs, if they're not used to growing Legionella, can't get it to grow. This is a very difficult organism to get to grow. So a lot of laboratories, if they're not clinical laboratories, if they're not used to getting Legionella to grow, will not be able to get this organism to grow. But if they can and they find Legionella, it's definitely the gold standard. If they get it to grow, you've definitely got Legionella in your patient. Urinary antigen. This is a very, very good test for community-acquired Legionella because urinary antigen is an immunoassay for the serogroup 1 LPS, which is mostly the community-acquired. It's not so good for anything other than serogroup 1 because it's specific for serogroup 1 antigen. This is the seroconversion. This is also really good, but the problem is that a fourfold or greater rise, that's great if you've got a starting point. What happens if you don't have a starting point? You can't see if you've got a rise. So generally, in that situation, you're going to look for 140 or 160-fold increase over what most people would consider normal. That's what you're going to see most of the time. You're not going to see a conversion. You're just going to see an increase of 160 or greater. The direct fluorescent antibody staining is also very good, and they have some of the other antibodies other than just serogroup 1. So again, if you can get the antibody staining on the sample, then that's a very good indication that the person has Legionella. Now, your book says that there are genetic probes and PCR. The CDC does not recommend the genetic probes and PCR because most of the clinical laboratories are not capable of handling it, and most of the time they're not that sensitive for Legionella. So these are the four tests that the Centers for Disease Control recommend that you use for the diagnosis of Legionella. Public health aspects. I was a witness in a court case recently for Legionella. Probably as a physician, you won't get involved in that, but there are a lot of court cases on Legionella because it is very much a community-acquired illness, and it is a community-acquired illness that is preventable. It is worldwide. Every country in the world has a problem with Legionella. It is sporadic. It is endemic. It is a community-acquired pneumonia. It is also a nosocomial infection problem. This is why you have court cases. Your exposure is based on water-based aerosols, specifically air conditioning cooling towers, whirlpool spas, saunas, and misters. The case I was involved in was a whirlpool spa. Someone rented a house. They had a whirlpool. Everybody enjoyed the whirlpool. This is the first time that they had used the whirlpool, it had been used. They hadn't cleaned it out properly. There was a biofilm that had developed. An elderly man sat next to where the biofilm had developed. The action of the whirlpool aerosolized the biofilm. There was Legionella in the biofilm. He breathed it. He got Legionella and died. His family sued because the whirlpool had not been treated properly. Now, there was a case in Scandinavia at a big, I think it was Whirlpools and Saunas show, where I don't remember exactly where the contamination was, but one of the whirlpools was contaminated. And everybody who walked by that whirlpool got a Legionella infection. So it is a problem. Now, the other problem is that the amoebas are more of a problem in the air conditioning cooling systems than biofilms, because you get these big cooling towers, and these amoeba love to live in these cooling towers or in water beside the roads and places like that where they get splashed, and that causes a problem. But the amoeba problem has been better solved than the biofilms problem because, again, in the air conditioning systems, they test for them. And if there's a lot of amoeba, they go ahead and they use chlorine. And chlorine is a good situation for killing in the environment. You can kill them very easily in that situation. So just remember that it is causes epidemic community-acquired pneumonias. It's a really big problem with whirlpool spas. Now, in the public health aspects too, the people that tend to get the pneumonia are older men who smoke. In the situation I was in, the only person that got the pneumonia was the grandfather who smoked. There were a couple of the younger, I say younger, in their 40s, who got positive titers with the antibody titers, but they didn't get sick. But it shows that they were exposed. But the only person who got sick was the oldest person that was there, and he was a smoker. So a lot of times what you'll see is you will see one person who gets the pneumonia. You might see some people who get Pontiac fever, which is another disease that's caused by Legionella, but we'll talk about that in a second. Okay, here we go. The two clinical presentations, Legionnaire's disease, which will kill you, and Pontiac fever, which won't. Legionnaire's disease, incubation period 2 to 10 days, it's a pneumonia. If you're normal and healthy, 15% mortality. If you're not, 75% mortality, erythromycin. Pontiac fever, 1 to 2 days, it's flu-like, it's very mild, doesn't tend to kill you, and it's very self-limiting. So if you have multiple people exposed, the older people, immune-compromised people, will get the pneumonia. The younger people who are very healthy tend to get the Pontiac fever. So the pathogenesis. What happens? Okay, in the environment, in the amoeba, it's an intracellular pathogen of the amoeba. In people, it's an intracellular pathogen of the monocytes. You get phagocytosis into the monocytes via the complement receptors. It inhibits phagosome-lysosome fusion. Then you get replication in the phagosome. Once you get replication in the phagosome, it just keeps on replicating until it lyses the phagosome. Then it keeps on replicating until you get apoptosis and release of the organism into the tissues, where it goes back in and again starts the cycle out all over again. The only way it tends to kill it is you get activated Th1 cells and gamma interferon. Humoral immunity has little or no effect on this organism. Okay, any questions on Legionella? Okay, now we're going to talk about Bordetella. Bordetella pertussis, whooping cough. We've all been immunized against whooping cough. Hopefully. It's a strict aerobe. It's gram negative. It's a small coccobacillus in singles or in pairs. It's transmitted by aerosol droplets. It's non-invasive, and it's strictly a human pathogen. There are three species of Bordetella that you'll hear about: pertussis, which causes whooping cough; parapertussis, which causes a milder form of whooping cough; and bronchoseptica, which causes kennel cough in dogs. But if you're immune compromised, it can make you sick. So the big deal here is the test that you use to differentiate it. Pertussis will not grow on common laboratory media. You require a specialized media, Bordeaux Jingu media. It's oxidase positive, whereas the bronchoseptica is the only one that's positive, all three, and it's non-modal. So if it doesn't grow on common laboratory media and it's oxidase positive, then it's pertussis. On the Bordeaux Jingu media, it is very, very, very small, transparent hemolytic colonies because there is blood in this media. Diagnosis is based on the symptoms, which we'll talk about in a minute. Culture on the specialized media. And this is tricky, and we'll talk about that in a minute as well. Direct fluorescent antibody testing and PCR in specialized situations, and slide agglutination tests, which are the last three are not as important. The first two are what you really want to think about: culture and symptoms. Fluorescent antibody testing, PCR, and slide agglutination are not as important. Okay, whooping cough. Here we go. Not really a problem since pretty much got the immunization. Not a problem, not a problem. Whoa, we're starting to see a problem again. Why is that? Well, it turns out that the immunization is really only good for about 10 years. After that, there's a natural cycle. You can see the cycle here. But after that, those of us who have not had a pertussis vaccine in 10 years are susceptible to the organism again. So those of us who haven't had a shot in a while, we could very well get whooping cough. Now what you see here is in the age groups. So children, young children who have not been completely immunized are going to have a problem. Then there's not a problem. And then you start to see a problem in the age groups where people have not been immunized. And then as you get older and you're not exposed to young children, you see a drop off. So adolescence, there's a problem. Right in here. So, and then people start getting immunized again. Because nobody really wants to have whooping cough. It's not a pleasant disease. So what do you see? All right. You get exposed to whooping cough. That is an incubation period of 7 to 10 days. When basically nothing happens. And you really don't, if you go for culture, you're trying to culture the bacteria on your specialized media, until the very end of the incubation period, you're really not going to be able to grow anything. You start to see symptoms, mild flu-like symptoms. You're not got really much of anything. But right in here, is their best opportunity to grow the bacteria. But even then, only about 50% of the time are you going to actually be able to grow the bacteria. But again, you know, you got 1 to 2 weeks of cold-like symptoms. You got a runny nose, you got a fever, you don't feel good, you're sneezing. Not so bad. Okay, this paroxysmal stage, 2 to 4 weeks of sick, really sick. You've got this horrific cough that can go on. I mean, you can have every few minutes, you can have this horrific cough that just goes on and on and on. And the whoops, it's an inspiratory whoop. Now, I'm going to try it, because every time I try to do the one on the net, I can never get it to go, but it's a, I'm not going to do it loud, because it always makes me cough. It's a sound. Now, that's what it sounds. It's an inspiratory whoop. But that can go on, and it can be violent, and it can go on and on and on, and it can be, and the secretions can be so bad they can make you vomit. And these people can just, they can't keep anything down because they're coughing so hard, and they're vomiting, and they're just miserable. And guess what? At this point, you can't culture any bacteria, and antibiotics, forget it. At this point, it's a toxin disease, and you're not. Antibiotics at this point are not going to help. They're not going to have any effect on the disease at all. So unless you can catch them right here when they just have a cold, or that's what it looks like, it's not going to have any effect. So at this point, for 2 to 4 weeks, they're like this. And then for 3 to 4 weeks or longer, it slowly starts to go away. Slowly. Now you've got a problem is because they can be coughing so hard and so long that they have seizures because they're not getting enough oxygen. Then they get secondary complications from secondary bacterial infections. So they can get pneumonias and encephalitis and otitis media. So you got all kinds of problems. Again, antibiotics are not going to do them any good. So all you can do is just keep an eye on them, try and keep them from getting secondary bacterial infections, and supportive care. So again, nobody wants to have whooping cough. It's a nasty disease, and as you get older, now the immunization has been designed for children. It hasn't been designed for adults. So we're kind of in a between a rock and a hard place as adults. We don't want to get it, but we're not immune to it anymore. Now let's talk about the pathogenesis. It's a two-stage disease. You have respiratory colonization, which takes the 7 to 10 days that we talked about, where you have no symptoms. You have positive cultures at the end of the stage, but then it becomes a toxin-mediated disease. Now, in colonization, you don't have fimbriae involved here. This is not fimbriae colonization. You have two bacterial components that are involved, however. The pertussis toxin and filamentous hemagglutinin. Those are the two things you need to remember for colonization, is the pertussis toxin and filamentous hemagglutinin. Okay, this is the pertussis toxin. Now you've got two, it's a 6-component toxin. These are the adhesins, subunit 2 and subunit 3. Subunit 2 binds to the ciliary lactosyl ceramide, right here. And subunit 3 binds to the leukocytic ganglioside, right here. These are the binding components, subunits 2 and 3. Okay. Hello. Remember, it's a toxin-mediated disease. And it's controlled through the central locus. The central locus is a two-component signaling transduction system which senses the environment and regulates the expression of the toxins at the same time. Okay. Inflammation will interfere with the clearance of the pulmonary secretions, which causes the coughing and the accumulation of the secretions. So that's why your cough will progress from the mild to the severe stage. And that's why it resolves very slowly, because you get so much inflammation. You also have evasion of a host defenses, so you get a lymphocytosis. Now, the toxins. Unfortunately for you, there are 5 different toxins that you have to remember. Okay, remember pertussis toxin back here? I'll go back. Oh, no, I've got to go back too far. I'll have to put in another picture. Subunit A. This is the toxin component. The biggest protein part here, the subunit A, is the toxin component. It has systemic effects. So the pertussis toxin does 2 things. It's involved in binding, and it has a toxin effect which has systemic effects. It is a T cell. It causes T cell lymphocytosis with decreased mitogenicity, increased insulin and histamine production, increased IgE production, impaired phagocytosis functions, and I thought I had fixed that. I'm sorry. So, increased insulin and histamine production, increased IgE production, and impaired phagocytic functions. But the biggie here is the T cell lymphocytosis with decreased mitogenicity. That's the big thing to remember with the pertussis toxin. The next big toxin, the next one that's really important, is the adenylate cyclase toxin, which has both an adenylate cyclase activity and a hemolysin activity. It's a secreted invasive toxin. All right, what you have is you have your pertussis bacteria. You have the adenylate cyclase toxin, which is found on the surface of the bacteria. What it is a pore forming toxin. I'll get those words out. So it forms a pore, and then it binds calmodulin, and it is activated by cellular calmodulin. Then what it does is it causes an increase in the cyclic AMP production, which inhibits chemotaxis, inhibits phagocytic activity, inhibits superoxide generation, and induces apoptosis. Okay, now the other 3 toxins are not as important, but you need to remember that they are there. You get a dermonecrotic toxin, which is also called lethal toxin. It's a strong vasoconstrictor. And you get a tracheal cytotoxin, which prevents ciliated epithelial cells from beating. And you have lipopolysaccharide, which is an endotoxin. And that completes the 5 different toxins. Treatment. Erythromycin. You have vaccines. Again, you have your DPT shot, which induces immunity, which wanes after 5 to 10 years, but generally it's 10 years. But now they have the acellular vaccines, which are multi-component vaccines. Whoops, let me go back to that. They consist of the pertussis toxoid, filamentous hemagglutinin, and two types of fimbriae. So these are going to be the multi-component acellular vaccines are probably better for adults. But again, most of the vaccines are designed for children. Yeah. Right.
Like, what would make us think that it could be?
I don't know. I'm not a clinician. I was cultured. I have problems with chronic cough. Mostly it's allergies, but my clinician cultured me just to make sure. I don't know why a clinician would culture for, unless they think that the person has just, the cough just doesn't go away.
And by the time the culture would grow up, you would already be past the phase that any antibiotics would help.
Right. Pretty much.
Sure.
Yeah. This is one of those catch-22 kind of things. You know, you want a culture, but if the culture grows and it takes so long to grow, by the time it grows, the antibiotics are not going to do you any good. But what you could do is you could start the rest of the family on antibiotics because it, again, unless there's young children, really young children who would probably still be immune, the parents might not be immune and that sort of thing. So I'm sure you'll get all this kind of stuff in your clinical rotations. Okay, the next organism that we're going to talk about is Haemophilus. Now, Haemophilus is an organism, again, it's very small, it's non-modal, it's a gram-negative rod. Again, it's transmitted via respiratory droplets or direct contact with contaminated secretions. This one is part of the normal flora of human respiratory tract or oral cavity. Haemophilus influenzae. Type B is an important human pathogen. There is now an immunization against type B, which has, in this country, pretty well taken care of type B infections. Ducree, which is not really a problem in this country, but is a problem in tourists or people who have been in South America or Asia and Africa, causes chancroid and other types of Haemophilus, which are part of the normal flora, parainfluenzae, Atrophilus, and Aegyptus, which causes pink eye. Okay, one of the big things here, and again, this is the type of thing that you see on exams, is growth factor requirements, factors X and Y, which we'll talk about. Influenzae requires X and Y. Ducree only requires X. Parainfluenzae only requires Y. And you can't tell a difference between influenzae and Aegyptus. It is a short. They'll say it's in, the books will tell you that it's in short chains, but I can't find any short chains in here, and in pairs, and I can sort of see some pairs, but to me it just looks like it's in singles. This was the best picture I could find. But the textbooks will tell you it's in pairs or in short chains. It requires isovitale X enriched chocolate agar, two erythrocyte factors, X, which is heme, and V, which is nicotinamide adenine nucleotide. The X and the Y are released from the lysis of red blood cells. So on agar, you can put patches with X and Y on them, and what you'll see is it will grow in between the two factors. It also likes a little bit of CO2. The other thing it'll do, this big, fat little streak right here, Staph aureus. Staph aureus is hemolytic. So what is it doing? It's lysing the red blood cells, which is releasing those two factors, X and Y. So what you can do is you get the Haemophilus influenzae growing right around the Staph aureus. This is called a satellite phenomenon. This is also one of the things that people like to put on tests. So you'll get it growing around the Staph aureus on sheep blood agar because it's hemolytic. Staph aureus is hemolytic. It releases those two factors. Influenzae, it's typed based on its capsular polysaccharides, and there are A through F types of capsular polysaccharides, and they're all different types. The type B, which is the one that there's the immunization against, is a polyribose ribitol phosphate capsule. That's also something that tends to be put on exams. Now, there are a significant number of H influenzae that are non-encapsulated. They are called non-typable. They are also part of the normal flora of the respiratory tract. So if they're non-typable, that means they are not encapsulated. 95% of all invasive disease was caused by the type B, which has got a polyribose ribitol phosphate capsule. The number of cases of H influenzae type B has fallen 99% since vaccination. This is important because this used to be a very significant cause of meningitis in young children. Vaccination is wonderful, but we have to remember that sometimes vaccinations fail. Sometimes people don't give their children vaccinations. I was watching, I don't remember which medical show it was, but there was a pediatrician and he was treating one of his patients. Mothers had decided that her oldest child had developed autism because he'd been given an immunization. So she refused to let her other children be given immunizations. And her next oldest child, it was a viral disease, but that's the point. It doesn't matter what the disease was. It was a preventable disease if she had gotten the child immunized. You hear about it on the news all the time, people who think their children got autism because they were immunized. So there are a number of people who won't have their children immunized because they're afraid they'll get autism. Those people are subjecting their children to the possibility of a lot of diseases. So you need to be aware that if your patients are not allowing their children to be immunized, they could very easily come down with a lot of these preventable diseases. Pre-immunization serotype B was the most common invasive species. Post-immunization, now what do we have to worry about? Unvaccinated or incompletely vaccinated children. Immunizations generally are more than one shot, and the schedule's usually several months apart. So if the child has only had one immunization shot and hasn't completed the immunization schedule until they've completed it, they are not fully vaccinated and they are susceptible to these diseases. Now we have to worry about the non-encapsulated and serotype F. serotype F now has become the most common type causing disease. But now pneumonia and meningitis are a lot less common. But approximately two-thirds of the infections now are due to non-typable or non-encapsulated strains. Now, what do we have? This is what used to be the case. Meningitis, 52% of children that came down with the serogroup B infections got meningitis. This can be spread person to person, and it peaked from 3 to 18 months. The next biggest problem really was epiglottitis, even though it's only 10%, pneumonia was more common, but this is a medical emergency because it causes acute respiratory airway obstruction. So, now, the disease that's caused by these post-immunization, you've got non-B disease, but it doesn't really make any difference if it's non-B or B at this point because it all looks the same clinically. You've got septic arthritis, osteomyelitis, cellulitis, pericarditis, pneumonia. Again, this is caused by serotype F, and otitis media. Now, the otitis media is more often caused by the non-typable, which is non-encapsulated. The pathogenic mechanisms here for H flu. It's the major pathogenic mechanism is the polysaccharide capsule. Now, remember, there's also a lot of the non-encapsulated strains. And in the non-encapsulated strains, it's the lipid A component of the cell wall. Now, in the all strains that are pathogenic can produce a neuraminidase and an IgA protease. No exotoxins. Now they're not considering the neuraminidase and the IgA protease to be exotoxins here. So this is not an exotoxin producing organism. That's another question that tends to pop up on exams. The vaccine is against the capsule, specifically the type B capsule. The vaccine does not protect against the non-typable or the non-encapsulated strains. People who are at risk. Basically, anybody who's immune compromised. One of the things that I left out here is that 2 to 4% of regular people are carriers of type B, and 50 to 80% of people are carriers of non-typable. So there's a lot of people out there that carry H-flu, H-influenzae. Now let's talk about Ducree. This is a sexually transmitted disease called chancroid. There are other types of organisms are H. influenzae biogroup aegyptus, which causes Brazilian purpuric fever, H. aegyptus, which causes pink eye, and H. atrophilus, which causes a pneumonia. We're not really going to talk about the others too much, but we are going to talk about Ducree. Okay, chancroid, approximately 5,000 cases per year. It's endemic in Asia and Africa. It's common cause of genital ulcers in Africa, Asia, and Latin America. The reason that it's important is because it is a facilitator of the transmission of HIV. These ulcers just seem to help the transmission of HIV significantly. It occurs in strands. It'll grow on chocolate agar, but requires X, but not V. This one I find interesting. You may not see this, but it's H. influenzae biogroup aegyptus. It causes Brazilian purpuric fever in children. It kills them within 48 hours. It's not very common, but it's very, very deadly. There doesn't seem to be a whole lot people can do about it, so. Okay, we can go over, I've got a couple of case studies here if you want to go over them, but I can let you go now if you want to go now. Do you want to look at these case studies real quick? Okay, here's your history. You have a 13-year-old white male. He has been fully vaccinated. He has cold symptoms and a persistent cough of 10 days duration. 2 weeks later, he has progressive coughing spells with an inspiratory whoop. What does that tell you? Right. Now, 2 weeks later, now he's 13, so he's past that 10-year time period for the vaccine. He's had his 10 days worth of cold symptoms. So chances are you're not going to be able to get a culture on this kid, right? Okay. Now, what are the things that you're going to have to really look for? And he's also got the pertussive vomiting. What kind of tests are you going to run? You're going to do nasopharyngeal swabs. Chances are not real good you're going to get anything. But you don't. This is the media you're going to grow it up on, right? Remember, with whooping cough or what's the bacteria? Bordetella pertussis. The serology is going to help you. Here you're going to look for IgM and IgA antibodies. Okay, this is the antibiotic treatment. It's probably not going to do you a whole lot of good either, but you're still going to put them on antibiotics. According to most of the case studies that I give you, I've actually pulled from the literature. These are actual cases that are presented as case studies in the literature. So this is exactly what somebody did for this kid. So they put him on erythromycin. They did nasal swabs and they did serology. So this is what some poor kid had to go through. Now the next case study is a four-month-old. Now with a four-month-old, are they going to have completed their immunizations? No, because immunizations are done at 2 months, 4 months, and 6 months. So this kid will have had at best one shot, maybe two, but probably only one. Comes in with 103-degree fever, lethargic, irritability, and a stiff neck. Could be. Now, because of the stiff neck, you're going to do cerebral spinal fluid cultures. Now, why are we growing it on chocolate agar with isovitalic X? What organism are you looking for? Haemophilus influenzae. Now, what is it in the isovitalic X enriched chocolate? It's going to help grow Haemophilus. X and Y. Or V. Whatever. All right. I'm so confused at this moment. I'm sorry. Why spinal fluid cultures? We would probably also do blood cultures. And you would look for blood cultures and spinal fluid cultures to match. If the same organism grows in the blood and the spinal fluid, then you would be very confident in what you've got. But the stiff neck and the irritability are what are going to give you away, and the age. You're going to, but again, you've got a four-month-old, so you know that there's a chance that they're going to have this, they're going to have the type B because they're not fully immunized. Recognizing, again, you've got to keep an eye on the age in this situation. Age is important because of the immunization schedule. Okay, that's all I've got. Anybody got any questions? Any answers? Okay, thank you.